Now, this verse, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. When we go through the book of Philippians, sometimes we read and we'll see a verse that jumps out upon us, and we'll highlight it and we'll put it to memory. But always remember that a verse just snatched out of the context is snatched out of the context. When you quote it, make sure you keep it within that context, otherwise you're misquoting the Bible. Now, this thing, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me, we might use it as I can be a millionaire through Christ, or I can be everything through Christ is according to the will of God, the will of Christ, the will of the Holy Spirit that works in us. I can do all things where Christ has put me in his work, in God's will. I can do everything through Christ which strengthened me. Not that I can do, Christ can, it's like an ATM machine or something that a tool that we can use for our own aggrandizement or enrichment or anything like that, any selfish motive. We can do all things through Christ, in the service of Christ who strengthens us, because Christ owns us, remember. We are Christ, we are bought with a price. Welcome, everybody, to our sixth lesson in our Sunday School series in the book of Philippians. Then we'll go on to the book of Colossians, and finally we'll do a lesson in Philemon. We are in currently the last lesson in the theme of joy, which is found scattered and constantly all over the book of Philippians. Speaking of joy, remember our first lesson was joy in prayer, and the second lesson was joy in adversity. There was joy in humility, joy in knowing Jesus, joy in peace, and now we're at joy in and contentment. This is in the second half of chapter 4 of Philippians. It's going to be from verse 10 down to verse 23. So let's, as our tradition is, read the scripture, the whole in its entirety, and then we'll do our little discussion. Verse 10, chapter 4, Philippians. But I rejoiced in the Lord greatly, that now at the last your care of me hath flourished again, wherein you were also careful, but ye lacked opportunity. Not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. I know both how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. Notwithstanding, ye have well done that ye did communicate with my affliction. Now ye Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church communicated with me as concerning giving and receiving, but ye only. For even in Thessalonica you sent once and again unto my necessity, not because I desire a gift, but I desire fruit that may abound to your account. But I have all and abound. I am full, having received of Epaphroditus the things which were sent from you, an odor of a sweet smell, a sacrifice acceptable, well-pleasing to God. But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Jesus Christ. Now unto God and our Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. Salute every saint in Christ Jesus. The brethren which are with me greet you. All the saints salute you, chiefly they that are of Caesar's household. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. So we are studying this lesson, the joy and contentment. Now, contentment is being satisfied. Contentment in the context of being in Christ, working for him, working with him, suffering for his sake, fulfilling the mission of the gospel, the propagation of the gospel. And in Paul's travels, in this case, as we noted earlier, that he is in Philippi in prison in the house of Caesar awaiting trial and to either be set free or to be executed or whatever, not knowing where. Remember, we started the chapter where Paul said, in adversity, the things that have befallen me are fallen rather for the furtherance of the gospel, where one preached Christ because of my situation, the brethren are more bold to speak Christ because of their newfound boldness in speaking the gospel, and those who also want to add affliction to my bonds. They preach the gospel, but not with sincere motives, but in each case, the gospel is being preached, and therein Paul says, I rejoice, and I will rejoice. And so Paul is saying, he's in Philippi, the church of Philippi had sent a gift. Now, he was in Rome for a period of time. So he's saying, basically, thank you for the gift that you sent by the hand of Epaphroditus. And Epaphroditus was mentioned at the latter part of chapter 3, in chapter 3, where he was sent and he brought the message and he had a zeal for them and he was sick. And in chapter 3, it was chapter 2, I'm sorry. Yet I suppose it necessary to send unto you Epaphroditus, my brother and companion in labor, and fellow soldier, but your messenger, and he that ministered to my wants. He was the one who brought the gift that you sent, partly what this letter is about, acknowledging of the gift that you sent. For he, that's Epaphroditus, longed after you all, and was full of heaviness, because that you had heard that he had been sick. For indeed he was sick nigh unto death, but God had mercy on him, and not on him also, but on me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. So I sent him therefore the more carefully, that when you see him again, ye may rejoice, that I may be less sorrowful. Receive him therefore in the Lord with all gladness, and hold such in reputation, because for the work of Christ he was nigh unto death, not regarding his life, to supply your lack of service towards me. Epaphroditus here is described by Paul as being in the work of Christ, being the messenger from the church of Philippi to bring financial aid to Paul in his time of need, not because Paul needed it, but for the furtherance of the gospel, which is the ultimate goal. And as Paul elaborates in the last this portion of scripture that we'll be looking at, we'll see that he received the gift, he thanked them for it, and he said, I recognize the gift, and it's not you sent it here now because you've always wanted to send a gift, but you didn't have the opportunity. That could mean they had the heart and the desire to send a gift to Paul. It could mean either of the three things. They had the heart and the desire to send the gift to Paul, but at the time they didn't have the money. That's one possibility. The second possibility is they had the money and the means, but they didn't know where. They didn't have the opportunity to the network, the system, the delivering the goods. They didn't have that, so they probably didn't know where to send it or how to send it, and perhaps they had nobody available to transport the gifts, because it's not like today where you could transmit some money or send it in the mail or do a bank transfer. Things weren't set up that way at that particular time in history. And so, so Paul said, I know that you cared and you wanted to send the gift, but you didn't have the opportunity. Not that I speak in respect of want, or not that I'm in need. For I have learned, and the key word we're in back in Philippians chapter 4, verse 11, not that I speak in respect of want, not that I thank you because I really need it or I want it, I'm so desperate for the gift, because I have learned that in whatever state that I am in, therewith to be content. Now this verse seems like a simple verse, but when you take it together with 2 Corinthians chapter 11, where Paul describes how he has learned to be content, we see how he says that he's been through all things and God has been with him. 2 Corinthians 11, I think. I'll pick up the context. Are they the ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more in laborers, more abundant in stripes, above measure in prisons, more frequently of death, in deaths often. 2 Corinthians 11, verse 23. Of the Jews, five times I received 40 stripes, save one. Thrice was I beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck. At night and a day have I been in the deep. In journeyings often, in perils of waters, in dangers of robbers, in dangers of mine own countrymen, in dangers of the heathen, in dangers of the city, in dangers in the wilderness, in dangers in the sea, in dangers among false brethren. The Bible uses the term perils. In weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst often, and fastings often, in cold and nakedness. Besides those things are that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. Who is weak? And I am not weak. Who is offended? And I burn not. For I must needs glory. I will glory in the things concerning mine infirmities. The God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is blessed forevermore, knoweth that I lie not. And he's speaking about how he was laying forth some of the sufferings he went through just for the furtherance of the gospel, the ministry that Christ has called him to. And so his statement in Philippians, talking about he has learned, he hasn't learned by reading a book, he's learned by experience of going through the Christ. And so he has learned that in whatever state, he's learned to be content, to be satisfied, for he knows that he's in the service of the God and the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ. He is serving the Lord Jesus Christ, his Lord, who has taken it upon himself to take care of him, to see him through all his trials and all his afflictions. And he orders the way that he takes. He knows everywhere he's going. He provides protection. He provides great grace and strength in suffering. In Philippi, where he was beaten, God preserved him in that prison so he could, through his circumstance, he wasn't in jail with Silas complaining about, oh, this is terrible, but he adapted himself to his circumstance, and he was praising God in the midst of his circumstances, and by which God used it to bring the Philippian jailer back in Philippi, to the Philippian jailer, to Christ. And therefore, because they had mistreated him so badly, he had to leave to stay in Philippi so that he could furthermore preach the gospel and establish a church there, which stayed with him through all his ministries. And now, at years later, when he's in Rome as a prisoner, they're still sending him support. So Paul says, I have learned through all the difficulties and the triumphs that I've had therewith to be content, because the source of his contentment doesn't come from the circumstances, it comes from the Lord Jesus Christ. Whatever state I'm in, to be content. So verse 12, I know both how to be abased, to suffer need, and I know how to abound, to have. Everywhere and in all things I am instructed both to be full, like everywhere and in all things, in all circumstances, I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. Notwithstanding, ye have well done that ye did communicate with my affliction. Now this verse, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. When we go through the book of Philippians, sometimes we read and we'll see a verse that jumps out upon us, and we'll highlight it and we'll put it to memory. But always remember that a verse just snatched out of the context is snatched out of the context. When you quote it, make sure you keep it within that context, otherwise you're misquoting the Bible. Now this thing, I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me, we might use it as, I can be a millionaire through Christ, or I can be everything through Christ, is according to the will of God, the will of Christ, the will of the Holy Spirit that works in us. I can do all things where Christ has put me in his work, in God's will. I can do everything through Christ which strengtheneth me. Not that I can do, Christ can, it's like an ATM machine or something that a tool that we can use for our own aggrandizement or enrichment or anything like that, any selfish motive. We can do all things through Christ, in the service of Christ who strengthens us, because Christ owns us, remember. We are Christ, we are bought with Christ. Christ is our Lord, God is the Father. God has highly exalted Christ and has given him all power. So when we're in the service of Christ, we're in the service of our Lord. So in Ephesians, we're told the servants to be subject to their masters and to serve them, because we don't serve them, we serve the Lord Christ. So in the service, our day-to-day life, we are ultimately in the service of God, our service of Christ, our Lord, rather than, even though we are in Christ's service, within the context of a job situation or somebody else that we have to serve, we answer to Christ. And so his standards is higher than any boss or anybody else. His standards is higher than theirs. And so once we fulfill his standards, then we're fulfilling the law. We're fulfilling his will. So Paul says, I can do all things. And if you notice, this verse is within the context of him knowing how to abound and how to suffer need, how to be hungry, and how to and how to be full. His source of this is learning through his circumstances, through the source of Christ, his Lord, and the circumstances where Christ has put him to serve. So he can do all things through Christ with respect to the to where he's been, his circumstances, and where Christ has put him. He's constrained by those boundaries. So we can do all things through Christ, in Christ's will, in Christ's service, for what he has done. We can't do all things through Christ outside of his will. All right, notwithstanding, verse 14, you have well done that you did communicate with my affliction. So Paul is saying you did well when you sent the gift, because even though I can do all things through Christ, even though I have learned, I'm not saying that I don't need your gift. Yes, your gift came in at the right time and it supplies my need. But remember, your gift is not to me. Your gift is a gift to me, but in the service of Christ. So you become my fellow laborers, and we're laboring together in the gospel, in the service of our Lord, Jesus Christ. Now, you Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel ministry between you and I, when I left Macedonia, no church communicated with me concerning giving and receiving except you only. For even in Thessalonica, when I was in the province of Thessalonica, going from place to place, ministering and propagating the gospel, you sent once and again unto my necessities. Not because I desire a gift, not because it's my desire that you send it to me, because we'll see as we go, especially in Corinthians, we'll see where Paul is saying that as I have the right to be to accept wages or sustenance from you, because the Bible says he that the horse that treadeth the corn, you can't muzzle the ox, and those who are ministers of the gospel shall be partakers of the gospel. But Paul said, I reserve this right for myself, that I didn't take anything, I worked with my own hands to supply my need, just so I wouldn't be a burden to you. My love and my care for you, I wouldn't be a burden, so I worked just to supply my needs, because I probably saw what the circumstances were. So the Philippian church sent to Paul wherever he went, because there was such a great love, and they invested in his ministry, in his work of this propagation of the gospel. And Paul says, "For not because I desire a gift, but I desire the fruit that may abound to your account." What Paul is saying, in supporting my ministry, in supporting the propagation of the gospel, and helping me fulfill the work of Christ by partaking, by partnering with me in this venture, we are laying up treasures in heaven. So this work that you're doing physically is a spiritual work. It's a work of Christ. And so we're laying up treasures in heaven, where, remember, the Lord says, well done, thou good and faithful servant. It's being a good steward of God's, what he has given us. And a lot of times we are the hands and the feet and the eyes and the caring of Lord Jesus Christ in fulfilling, because how does somebody hear about the gospel? They hear from one of his people who are by the testimony of our lives, by outreach. The gospel spreads individually by outreach and by preaching and by communicating of people. This is how the gospel spreads. And so the Philippians, who have the means and the care for Paul and for the ministry of the gospel, when they give to him, they give to the service of the gospel, not necessarily to Paul. Because Paul says, my God can supply all my need. It says, Jesus Christ has shown me how to be content, and I can do all things. He's not downplaying the role of their gifts. He's saying his gifts, he desires the gifts for them, for their spiritual glory. Not because I desire a gift, but I desire fruit that may abound to your account. I have all, and abound. I am full, having received of Epaphroditus the things which were sent from you, an odor, a sweet savor, a smell, a sacrifice, acceptable, well-pleasing to God. Paul says he's got the gift that you sent by Epaphroditus. But to God, it's an odor of a sacrifice, a sweet smell to God. It's a spiritual gift that abounds in relation sometimes to the Old Testament sacrifices, where the Jews did. They had not just, there was a sin offering, there was a thank offering, there was the offering, that the wave offering, when the land brought forth, they burned and they brought the sacrifices to God, and they burned the animals, and Moses described it as a sacrifice, a sweet smelling savor unto the Lord. And Paul is using this same analogy and saying, this gift that you have sent is an odor, a sweet-smelling savor, well unto God. He's harking back to the Old Testament of how the Jews sacrificed to God through their gifts. They brought it to the priest. The priest would offer it to God the way that it was prescribed, and God would accept it. And so what he's saying, this is an acceptable gift to God on your behalf, and it will abound to your glory in heaven, because you're adding to your account, your heavenly account. And he's saying, you fulfilled my want, but my God shall supply, verse 19, all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. See, God does not supply our needs out of any necessity of things that we do. He knows what we need. God gives us, and he gives it according to his riches, and his riches is abundant, unlimited, limitless, and he gives it through Christ Jesus, the one whom we serve, the one whom we emulate, the one who we try to be like him. We learn of him. We learn of his meekness. We learn all about him. God will supply his need, our needs, all their needs, according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. So Paul says, I can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth me. He's alluding to the fact that God is supplying his needs through the riches of Christ Jesus. And in fact, the Philippians was one of the means of God supplying his needs through Jesus Christ, because these people were Christians. They were belonged to Christ. They were in Christ. And through their status in Christ and their concern for their love for the Apostle Paul and their buying into the ministry, and also by sharing in the gospel, they sent, communicated to Paul, and through the riches in Christ Jesus. Now, God owns the world. Jesus owns the world. He doesn't need anything that we can offer him, because everything is his. So if we give to God, or if we withhold from God, we're giving to him what's his, and we're withholding from him what's his. So what the Philippians are doing, they're doing things that are right. They're thinking logically, they're thinking rightly, because I'm helping in the gospel of Christ through Paul, and it's also a savor of sacrifice to God, and God is supplying my need through Christ Jesus, by which I can also supply by Paul. And Paul is saying, I have everything. A sweet savor unto the Lord. My God, verse 19, shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. And so he bursts into a doxology in verse 20. Now unto God and our Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. Now unto God. And Paul is speaking about God the Father. But he speaks of God the Father not just as the ubiquitous God all over, but a personal God. My God. Our God. Jesus teaches us to pray. When you pray, say, our Father. Appropriate to him a belonging, a sense of belonging. God is not just God in the heavens, but he's our God. He's our Father. And so God deals with us not in the way he deals with it. He deals with us as a father, his children, through his pity, through his care, through his love, and through his mercy. And God deals with us. And Paul says, now unto God our Father be glory forever and ever and ever. All things for the glory of God. And so we need to think about this small verse, it might look like a doxology, but it says, unto God and our Father. If we begin at the chapter 1, the introduction to Philippians, where Paul says, grace, verse 2, grace unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm suspecting if we go to Colossians, we begin verse 1, we'll see, verse 3, we give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, to the saints and faithful in Christ, which are at Colossae, grace unto you, verse 2, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. God is ours. We're his children. And there is such a assurance and a peace that comes from that. And so Paul sings, unto God our Father be glory forever and ever. And so everything is for the glory of God. We do everything for the glory of God. All our thoughts, all our deeds, all our service, everything should be for the glory of God. And so now the end of the chapter 21, 22, 23 speaks of, well, this is really a letter from Paul in Rome to the church in Philippi. And he's saying, those every saint in Christ Jesus, the brethren, the brothers, which are with me, So Paul had a set of people that were along with him, identified with him as Christians. They're called brethren. They greet you. Send greetings to the church. Paul, make sure you send the greetings to the church at Philippi for us. All the saints salutes you. Chiefly, the saints are the sanctified ones, which is synonymous to verse 21, where it says the brethren and the saints salute you, chiefly, specifically, those that are of Caesar's household. Now, Caesar was the emperor of Rome, and his household was the court of Rome, the senators and the servants and the wives, the families. They became Christians through the influence of the gospel, Christians going to Rome. Paul being Paul was in Rome for 2 whole years. The Bible says that he was in his own house for 2 years, disputing daily with the Jews and everybody who would come to him, trying to convince them that Jesus indeed was the Christ, in the last chapter of Acts. I think it was the last or second to last paragraph. So Paul was in Rome for a while. And so through his influence and through his preaching of the gospel, he made friends in high places, and the gospel spread and people became saved in Caesar's household. They of our Caesar's household salute you. They want to give greetings to the church who's in Philippi in another province. Christians, newly converted Christians. So the influence and the power of the gospel is shown in some historical verses where it talks about you will get extra information where names will be mentioned, and sometimes you'll find corroboration in the book of Acts as we go through the historical journeys of the Apostle Paul. But in every, we see the love. We see brethren saluting brethren, and some other historical facts that you'll see. And then it ends with the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Thank you very much for indulging in this lesson with us. Next week, we'll start the book of Colossians. We'll do an additional 6 lessons in Colossians, and the theme in Colossians will not be joy. It will be the gospel. It will be the gospel. So we'll spend some time in Colossians highlighting different portions of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you.